Dear students, welcome to the Visual Analytics lecture on decision trees. Decision trees is an important example for data mining, a technique frequently used in order to classify data. One can construct different decision trees for classification problems. They may differ in their complexity and their interpretability, but also in their accuracy, so there are a number of trade-offs. Decision trees can be automatically constructed or interactively by an expert with an appropriate system. And they involve a lot of essential information that needs to be conveyed to communicate decision trees, also to evaluate them and think about their plausibility. Yeah, I start here with two images from a medical example where we basically tried to classify whether or not a woman with a breast tumor has indeed a breast cancer, which would be a malignant case, or a benign case. Yeah, we have different splitting criteria, splitting nodes that I don't want to explain in this moment. But at the end, it turns out whether a tumor is malignant, that's the M here, or benign. Yeah, and we have a certain number of misclassifications with our simple tree here. So that is also a typical situation in this search for decision trees. By the way, the most important criterion here was the age of the patient. Yeah, so no sophisticated diagnosis, but the simple fact whether the woman was elder than 61 or not was quite important to understand whether a tumor is probably malignant or benign. Yeah, so that is my preview a little bit on this topic of decision trees. The outline is as follows. First, we briefly discuss how decision trees are constructed, if they are constructed automatically. As always, I want to give you an impression of such techniques, data mining techniques. I want to present an example for an algorithm and the criteria and parameters that are used in this algorithm. My goal is not to give you a comprehensive overview of all methods to construct decision trees and to explain in detail all algorithms and all implementation details to make this efficient. Yeah. So to some extent, we consider this more as a black box. Imagine that we have such an algorithm available. We can parameterize it, how we can incorporate the results, how we can visualize the results, how an analyst can interact with decision trees and ask for alternative decision trees that basically provide an alternative explanation of the data. So the first part is the construction of the trees, and the second part is the interactive visualization. And of course, I start always with visualization goals, requirements, and tasks that should be solved with decision trees. And then we discuss basic and advanced visualization techniques. Decision trees classify the data often with a binary output. In my introductory example, it was whether a tumor is benign or malignant, finance, it's often whether a credit is safe or very unreliable. So that's also a binary decision. A regression tree is a variant where the output is not a binary decision, but a continuous variable. Yeah, the trees are somehow similar, but the target value is not. So that's what we will discuss at the end. Yeah, decision trees are developed to support decision-making processes. So my initial example was one example for the large family of decision trees that have been developed to support physicians in diagnosing a disease. Yeah, they need to know which are the decisions that they have to make first. Maybe a few diagnostic tests are already sufficient in most of the cases to exclude a disease. Yeah, so these decision trees are often not balanced. Yeah. It may turn out that immediately after some very simple tests, a certain value can be excluded. If it cannot be excluded, we have to make more tests, have to go in more detail. So for example, the woman with a tumor in her breast may get not only a mammography, but also an ultrasound image, which leads to new features, and that could be integrated in a decision tree for more complex cases. Yeah? A decision tree, and that's nice, is a very intuitive knowledge representation, in particular if it is shown in a way like I did it in my initial example in a so-called node link diagram, yeah, where we really clearly see the hierarchy that is imposed, the tree structure that arises, the edges in the tree marked as lines with arrows. That is, for example, very familiar to physicians. Yeah. Why can I say this? Because I often have a look in medical journal papers, and they often represent diagnostic algorithms. That's the term that they use frequently. And the way a diagnostic algorithm is described there is a decision tree, very frequently. So based on this, one can say that many users appreciate decision trees because what they present is quite understandable. The classification may be performed with maximum likelihood estimation or support vector machines. We will see examples how this can be used to construct decision trees or neural networks, yeah, just to give you a first idea. Yeah, let me be a bit broader with respect to applications. I hope that would be motivating to you to discuss some further applications. Imagine that we have our photo collection, and we want to automatically classify them. That may be helpful to later find particular images. So a very simple classification could be in outdoor images and indoor images and portraits, where particular one or a very few persons are shown with their face visible quite well. Yeah? And this classification can be performed based on the background color that is somehow identified, or the foreground color, or measures that characterize the homogeneity in the data. Yeah? In a collection of tumors in medical image data, often a very important decision is to classify them in benign, or suspicious and malignant. Suspicious is something in between benign and malignant. So at the end, we need really a decision. Is this tumor benign? Then we maybe need not to operate it at all. Or is it malignant? Then we need to remove it completely with a safety margin, and probably other treatment is necessary as well. The in-between class of suspicious basically means we need further investigations to come up to with a decision. Yeah. So what could we use here as information? A tumor has a certain shape. It could be round, compact. It could be star-shaped. Yeah. So it could have a quite complex configuration and layout. The intensity values of all the voxels that belong to a tumor can be quite different. So this could be either a rather homogeneous structure that appears with a high contrast to the surrounding tissue, but it could also be that the contrast is lower, sometimes it's only higher. And we also could look for features that characterize the tumor margin. So primarily we could look for the strength of the gradient to the surrounding tissue. Yeah? This gives us features, so-called radiomics features, that could be used as input for a decision tree. So in finance data, of course, an essential application is to classify credits as safe or very risky, as good or bad. Yeah? By the way, it's clear that we can make errors with our classification. In any real-world example, there will be a certain amount of errors. Our tree will not have 100% accuracy. Yeah? And then you may ask, well, which kind of errors may occur? So for example, here in finance data, we can have the situation that we classify a credit as safe, although in fact it is not, and if it is a large credit, then the bank may lose a lot of money. That would be one type of error. The other type of error is that we classify the credit as bad, and therefore we won't give this credit, but in fact it would be a safe credit. Yeah? And you may ask whether both types of errors are similarly severe. Actually, they are not. Yeah, if we make a wrong classification in the sense that the bank may lose a lot of money, that is the larger problem for the bank. Yeah, and the same would be with medical image data and the classification of a tumor in benign or malignant. If we assess a tumor as benign, although it is a cancer, a malignant tumor, then this means that we postpone treatment maybe for several months because the person, it could also be a male person, of course, thinks that he has only a benign tumor. And that, of course, reduces the likelihood that we can treat and cure the patient. On the other hand, if a benign tumor is considered as malignant, that's another type of error that also has bad consequences, namely that the patient gets treatment which has side effects and is involving some burden which would not be necessary. But probably with this type of error, the patient would not lose his life. Yeah? So therefore, the other type of error is more severe. We come back to this problem later. Yeah? So to give just one more example, in remote sensing, so for example, with a plane, we make many photographs of the landscape and want to detect the resulting images with respect to whether there is a wildfire, yeah, perhaps in regions that are hardly accessible, or whether there is a sign for forest decline, or whether there are grasslands. Yeah, so that's an example how such images may be classified, and decision trees may reveal which features are essential for this classification process. So compared to some other methods that we have described and discussed so far, like for example clustering, decision trees are a supervised learning method. Yeah? So here an expert really is involved. It is applied to classify data according to a target variable that is typically a categorical variable, and in many cases it's even a binary variable. We do not want to make any assumptions on the data distribution. So, and we want to use the decision tree to predict the target variable based on the attribute values. Yeah? For constructing the decision tree, we need training data, we need historical data. So for example, in our medical example, we need examples for tumors with all their features where we know for sure and reliably whether this was a malignant tumor or a benign tumor. Yeah? So if this woman, for example, later died from cancer, then certainly the tumor was a cancer. And on the other hand, when a tumor was classified as benign and there were follow-up investigations for more than 5 years, and there was no sign of malignancy for a longer period of time, then we can absolutely be sure the original tumor must have been a benign tumor, otherwise that would have caused a lot of health problems to the patient. Yeah? So that is the so-called ground truth data that we need. In finance, it's very clear that a bank will analyze their previous credits and want to learn from them which credits turned out to be bad and unsafe and which turned out to be good. Yeah, that is the type of data that they use for constructing, for example, a decision trees that predicts for a credit application whether it will be one that causes headaches to the bank or not. A decision tree is a tree structure, so it's a hierarchical structure. It has a root node that basically applies to the whole data set. And then there are splitting nodes with splitting attributes. Yeah? In the example I showed in the beginning, the age of the patient was an important criterion. So age was the splitting attribute. And the splitting node basically used a threshold to classify the data in being the patients, in being younger or older than this threshold splitting attribute. Edges represent the splitting process, and in the leaf nodes, we assign a class label. Yeah. Yeah, so once more, a decision tree is a tree structure with a root node, with internal split nodes, and with terminal nodes or leaf nodes. Yeah, that is the end of the hierarchy. Yeah, here is a very simple example. Yeah, with yes, no decisions, binary decisions. There are algorithms that search for decision trees. They may be guided by some user input. So, for example, the user may specify certain characteristics of the resulting tree. Most important are input parameters that restrict the size of the tree. You may imagine that for a given training data set, if you can add more and more splitting nodes and leaf nodes, the accuracy probably will increase. In many cases, only slightly, but it will increase. On the other hand, a decision tree that is very large is not desirable. Yeah, you may end up with, if you have data with, let's say, 20 different dimensions or features and several hundred of data sets, you may end up with a decision tree that has more than 50 nodes. Even if, in principle, decision nodes are easy to understand, if the hierarchy is too complex, the layout would be difficult. You cannot show everything at once. You cannot provide sufficient labels. Then it gets difficult to understand. Yeah. So therefore, large decision trees are not desirable. They are also not desirable because it is more likely that a large decision tree is somehow the result of overfitting to the training data. That means the large decision tree probably is not so appropriate if you want to generalize it to other data. Yeah? So some parameters may control the complexity of the resulting nodes. Yeah, visualization serves for model construction and for model evaluation. And interaction can be used first in order to specify parameters for the construction of the decision tree, but also for editing the trees. Yeah, I mean, an expert may know that despite certain automatically computed splitting nodes, it's not a good idea to use certain information. So therefore, he may remove certain nodes. He may also grow the tree with adding some nodes where, based on her experience, it is clear to her that this is an essential criteria. Yeah, so that is the role of interaction combined with visualization with respect to decision trees. Yeah, some pragmatic aspects. I mentioned already and want to emphasize this again that interpretability is the most important advantage of decision trees in the classification of data. Yeah. So complexity directly affects interpretability. That is very clear. It is hard to grasp important attributes if you have a large tree with many nodes that are somehow distracting from the most important decisions that are taken there. A smaller effect on the interpretability, but that should also be not neglected, is the specific choice of splitting values. Yeah. So imagine that the age of a patient is important to predict whether or not this will be a severe disease or not. Then, yeah, we can compute very precisely what is the optimal threshold for this splitting. Yeah, and maybe it turns out it is 61.75 years. That's a quite complex number. Yeah, maybe we should round it to 62 years. Probably we don't make a large additional error with rounding it to 62 years. Maybe we even don't make a large error if we round to 60 years. Yeah, and then of course the memorability of 60 years is better than that of 61.75 years. Yeah, so as an input parameter to some decision tree algorithms, you can specify whether splitting values should be rounded or not. Another pragmatic aspect are acquisition costs. Yeah, imagine that in medicine, in order to diagnose a disease, we could achieve an almost 100% accuracy if we take blood samples of the patient and analyze these blood samples for a few dozen of substances. Yeah, how large is the portion of certain vitamins and metallic components and other substances in the blood? And we also can analyze urine samples for many dozens of criteria, and then we have many other things that we could measure in principle. Yeah, even if it would be possible to come up with such a perfect diagnosis, in clinical practice, probably that would be avoided, because to analyze the blood with respect to so many substances, and also the urine with respect to so many substances, causes a lot of money. Yeah, that's expensive. Yeah, and also you have to wait for the results, perhaps a week. Yeah, so if you could come up with a diagnosis based on fewer features that can be analyzed easier and can be acquired faster and without so much cost involved, that would be better. Yeah, so therefore, cost justification may also play a role. To give you another example, not from medicine, there is research in the car industry about which sensors are actually needed in order to understand the state of the car for automatic driving, for example, autonomous driving. Can we replace some expensive sensors with can we completely remove it, or can we replace it with cheaper sensors? So there also decision trees are constructed with cost justification aspects in mind. Yeah, so how do decision trees work? We need good training data, of course. Think back to our initial set of applications. Yeah, we need a large photo collection with many indoor images and outdoor images and portrait images and maybe animal images. Yeah, so all classes need to be available. And the same, of course, if we want to classify tumor cases, then we need really many examples of benign and malignant tumors. And also in finance, we need good training data. The data is analyzed with respect to all relevant features that represent a feature vector for each element. Yeah, feature vector would contain, let's go back to this photo example, background color, foreground color, other features that may be derived from the histogram of the data set, maybe not only a global histogram, maybe we overlay a grid on the data and compute local histograms for different grid cells. That all may give us features that could be used for a classification and for a decision tree. Yeah, so the decision tree is computed to classify certain input data. The basic algorithm that is often used or refined for decision trees is a top-down algorithm. It tries to find first an attribute that serves very well as a top-level splitting node, and then wants to find from the remaining attributes, again, highly important nodes for further classification. It is a greedy search algorithm that recursively splits the data set in subsets, and these subsets are not overlapping. Yeah, or to say it alternatively, they are mutually exclusive. So one essential algorithm is the algorithm introduced by Quinlan already in the 1980s. It starts with an empty tree and the entire training data set. If all samples at the current node are of the same class, then this node becomes a leaf node and gets the class label C. So if we only have malignant tumors in our database, then we are ready. No matter which other attributes we have no need to split. Yeah? So that would be an example that makes no sense. So probably we need splitting nodes. Yeah? So let's look in the else branch here. Else, we select a splitting attribute S, S for splitting, that is most useful to separate the samples into distinct classes. Most useful means that with respect to our target variable, ideally we want to see something if we use this splitting attribute and a certain threshold, where all positive examples are in one class and all negative examples in the other. We make no error with this one splitting node. That's very unlikely. Yeah. So what we choose in practice is a splitting node where at least a large majority is in one class and a large and only a minority in the other class. And then we need further splitting nodes and splitting attributes in order to refine the selection. Yeah. So this process is recursively applied. And this raises, of course, the question, when do we stop? Yeah, when our decision tree is ready, it's a top-down process, so it grows to the bottom. When do we stop adding further splitting attributes? Yeah, we need some stopping criteria. So at each level, we are searching for a best splitting attributes and determine a splitting value as a threshold like the age that I have discussed. Yeah. That is a local optimization. Yeah, that's essential to note. So that means a decision tree that is automatically constructed, it is not necessarily, in a global sense, the best decision tree for these data. That means it could be possible that there are decision trees which have a higher accuracy. And indeed, there are documented examples in the literature where experts, with all their a priori knowledge, tried to generate decision trees, and they came up with decision trees that are better than the algorithm from Quinlan, for example, automatically computed. Yeah. So why is this similar to other situations that we have discussed already? A global optimization here would be an NP hard problem. That means the computational effort grows exponentially with the number of features that we have. So therefore, that is not feasible for a larger set of data, yeah, with many features. So Quinlan's algorithm produces a decision tree that's a local optimum, could be quite good, but could also be quite complex. Yeah. So therefore, there are also automatic approaches that take as input an existing decision tree and try to reduce the complexity, and that's called pruning. Yeah, pruning is an operation that is applied to a tree structure with the goal of reducing the set of nodes and edges and thus to simplify the tree. So the implementation details differ considerably. That's not what surprises you too much. There is a survey article, you find it in the list of references at the end from 2005, that discusses such implementation details, how a pruning step is actually realized, for example. Yeah. There are also attempts, without going into detail here, that use ensemble learning. That is a general strategy in machine learning for classification tasks, that we do not only have one classifier, but let's say four or five classifier, and with a careful and smart combination of the results, the combined classifier may yield an accuracy that is better than the best individual classifier. Yeah, that may be at first glance a bit surprising. You may think, if one classifier is better than the others, why should I merge the results with those from worse classifiers? Doesn't this lead to something like the average accuracy of the individual classifiers? Just to briefly explain why the sum of the classifiers could be better than the best classifiers, the classification processes involve a kind of estimation of the certainty of the classification. Yeah? So an algorithm tries to estimate how reliable is my classification. And a classifier that may be good for certain data is not so good for some other data, perhaps because there is a strange distribution of the data, for example. So if the algorithms can reliably estimate their accuracy, it may turn out that the globally best algorithm in a particular situation can assess, I'm not so sure, and another algorithm that is often not so good is better for this specific example. If this could be modeled quite good, indeed ensemble learning can improve the results. Yeah, there are good examples that show that this is really possible. It's not only a theoretical possibility. Yeah, so what happens if after a split the child notes do not have all the same class? If they have the same class, it's clear that we are ready. We do not need any further note and splitting attribute. And even more important, we have an accuracy of 100%. Yeah, that is not the typical situation. The typical situation is that we have different results for the child loads with respect to the class label, so we may search for further splits. And the stopping criterion combines several things. On the one hand, we may stop if our accuracy, which we can easily measure after applying each splitting criterion, is above a certain threshold. This criterion is definitely fulfilled if we have a 100% accuracy. Since we typically do not achieve a 100% accuracy, our threshold should be typically chosen smaller. Maybe it is 90% or 95%. But of course, it may happen depending on the distribution of our data and the overlapping of the class labels in the attribute space. We may never reach this threshold. So we need other termination criteria as well. And one criterion is, of course, if we add further nodes and the accuracy basically remains the same. Yeah. So the additional accuracy that we win with adding a new set of splitting nodes is very small, then we should not do this, because we add complexity without gaining a lot of accuracy. So at some point we stop, and then we use majority voting. Yeah, that means we assign to a child node the class label that occurs more often. Yeah, we will see examples for this. So here's a very simple example. The goal is to predict heart disease, yeah, coronary artery disease, for example, based on certain symptoms of the patient. The first one is subjective symptom, namely whether the patient reports chest pain. Yeah? So we have here a little less than 300 patients. 139 of them have, in this example, a heart disease, and 164 have no heart disease. Yeah? If the patient reports chest pain, the majority indeed has heart disease, but not all of them. Yeah? Approximately 30% have no heart disease despite of chest pain. And from those that have no chest pain, 34 have a heart disease. So chest pain is not a mandatory symptom if you have a heart disease. But if you have no chest pain, the majority of the patients has no heart disease. Yeah? So that is one possible splitting note that we could use for a classification with respect to having heart disease, yes or no. Then there are features derived from the global blood circulation. That is not something that the patient can report, but you need some measurements for this. And based on this measurement, if the global blood circulation is somehow disturbed, then 100 patients have a heart disease and only 33 have no heart disease. If the global blood circulation seems to be normal, 127, so that's the clear majority, have no heart disease, but 37 have, yeah, despite having a good and normal global blood circulation. So that is an alternative splitting mode. And the third one is whether the patient has blocked arteries, yes or no. If he has blocked arteries, very likely he has a heart disease. Yeah. So we have three times as many yes compared to no. But even if we don't have blocked arteries, we have 45 persons that have heart disease without blocked arteries, but more than 120 have no heart disease. Yeah. So good blood circulation, if we look at these three values here, is slightly more predictive and more interesting compared to chest pain and blocked arteries. So our decision tree would use as first criterion for diagnosing a person with having either heart disease or not, the fact whether the global blood circulation is normal or not. Yeah? And the two other attributes would also be part of the tree, may help to discriminate between these 37 and 127 that we have here, as well as also here, hopefully with getting an even clearer decision. If this would be the only splitting node, we would end up with an accuracy in the area of 70%. Yeah, and that's of course not a very good result. Yeah, there are different measures that are used for goodness of a split, or impurity measures, as it is also called. Purity would mean that after a split, we end up in a situation where the very large majority is in one class. And impurity is the opposite. We need further splitting in order to achieve a pure and clear situation. The measures that are typically used are derived from information theory. The Gini gain is one important one, and the information gain that is incorporated in Quinlan's algorithm that I have already briefly mentioned. Yeah, let me also mention input parameters that serve as stopping criteria. Yeah, we discussed that this is necessary. And here are some examples based from the SAS Enterprise Miner, to give you an example of a specific commercial data mining system. There you can specify for a decision tree the maximum branches that it should have. Yeah? So graph theoretically, that is the maximum number of edges. You may also specify a maximum number of layers that the tree has. Yeah, and that is a measure that is not completely independent from the first one, but you can also not say that it is 100% correlated. If you have a strongly imbalanced tree, you may easily reach a maximum number of layers, although the maximum number of branches is still not reached. You may also limit the number of leaves that arise in the tree. You may limit the number of decision nodes. You may say, for example, if in one node we have only a small number of attributes below a threshold, then I would not look for a further splitting attribute to make this selection even smaller. Yeah. So if we have, let's say, a database with 500 data sets, we don't want to end up with a single leaf node for each and every data set in our database. Yeah, that would be too much. Yeah, so to briefly comment on information gain, that's based on entropy. So we have k classes in which we want to classify. And then we compute the entropy based on the binary logarithm. So that gives us entropy. And based on the entropy, the information gain can be computed. Yeah, you see entropy is integrated here in this formula. Yeah, A is the attribute for the splitting node. S is the number of items in the current node. Yeah. The magnitude of this set. Information gain is biased towards attributes with a large range. That is an important consideration and needs some transformation before. So if you have a binary variable or a categorical variable with only a few possible values, then probably this attribute is not chosen as a splitting attribute. Whereas instead a numerical value that has a large range and many possible values, that is used more often. That could remind you to discussions that we had on clustering, for example, and also for dimension reduction, where we employed methods such as centralization and normalization to make sure that the ranges are similar, and that is then used as input for a distance metric, for example. Yeah, if all our attributes have large numerical ranges, we have no problem here. But if we have heterogeneous data with some binary or categorical data, and then scalar data on the other hand, that would represent a problem that needs to be corrected to avoid this bias. Yeah, the algorithm from Quinlan, that's the C4.55 algorithm, and that used information gain for selecting the splitting criterion and the gain ratio, that is another information theoretic measure for actually determining the splitting value. Yeah, to explain this again with a medical example, age could be the splitting criterion, or one could also say the splitting attribute, and the 61 point something was the splitting value. CART is another decision tree algorithm that is an abbreviation for classification and regression tree algorithm that employs the Gini game. Yeah. Yeah, a few remarks on the input parameters. In Weka, for example, frequently used data mining library, you have 11 parameters to specify as input for a decision tree algorithm. That is good on the one hand because you really can employ your expert knowledge as an analyst to fine-tune how the algorithm is constructed. On the other hand, with 11 parameters, you typically cannot explore all combinations of input values, so you probably use a combination that is somehow suboptimal. The effective adjustment of parameters requires an understanding of two things. On the one hand, the algorithm, of course, but on the other hand, also of the specific data. Yeah? A certain set of input parameters that may be useful in many situations and applied to many data, maybe not so fortunate for a new data set which has some very different characteristics. Yeah, so fewer measures are better. Let me make one remark with respect to missing data. Yeah, I mentioned, I think, in the introductory lecture already that missing data is a frequent problem in any large collection of data. There are many reasons why it is hard to avoid that not all data sets are complete. And if we want to make follow-up investigations, probably not for all patients, for example, we have follow-up data. So therefore, for all kinds of data mining and visual analytics, an essential question is how well these methods can handle missing data. Yeah, and decision tree algorithms are really bad with this. They assume that the data is complete. Yeah, so therefore, well, imputation strategies could be used in order to guess the missing values, or we remove all data sets that are not complete, which may lead to the situation that we have to remove the majority of our data sets. Yeah. So these are situations that can occur here. Yeah, for categorical data, the C4.5 algorithm works very well. For numerical data, splitting lines need to be computed. And yeah, we will also see how this could be done interactively based on scatter plots where the user can draw lines within. Yeah, binary decision trees are those where every split generates two nodes. Yeah, that is a restriction. There are also general decision trees where we would split a numerical variable, let's say, in three or four intervals. Yeah, so the risk for a severe progress of a COVID-19 disease, for example, is quite different for persons younger than 40 years compared to those between 40 and 60 years, and it's again quite different between 60 and 70 years and above 70 years. So I may use such intervals to split the patients in order to predict whether they likely will have severe disease. So then probably we should admit them to the hospital better earlier than later in order to avoid a very problematic course of the disease. Yeah, what are potential disadvantages of decision trees? As a supervised technique, there is a considerable risk of overfitting to the training data. Overfitting could be observed when we only slightly change the input data, for example, by adding a few new data sets or by deliberately altering a few values slightly. If this has a strong effect on the resulting trees, then we know that this decision tree is not very reliable and probably strongly overfitted to the data. Yeah, I mentioned already that a global optimal solution cannot be guaranteed. That is just the case because in every step the search for a splitting attribute is local. That means the algorithm does not take into account somehow what are the consequences based on the current decision for future decisions and the overall resulting accuracy. Yeah, that is not taken into account. Yeah, so to avoid overfitting, careful validation is necessary. And as a general remark, a complex explanation, and in this example, a complex tree, has a higher risk of being overfitted to the data. Yeah, so as a general strategy in machine learning, data mining, training data and evaluation data should be separated. One strategy, if your training data is not so large, is cross-validation, where you partition the data in k samples of equal size, for example, 5 samples of equal size, and you compute first a decision tree for the whole data, but you leave the first sample out. Yeah, let's stick with this example where we have 5 samples, they all have equal size. That means we remove 20% of our data and compute a decision tree. And we use then the left out data for validation. Yeah, so we apply the same decision tree for the left out data and want to see how correct is our classification. And we do this not only once, but we do it for all samples. Yeah, so we leave the first 20% of the data out, then the second 20%, then the third, the fourth, and the fifth. Yeah, so that we have 5 different sets, all representing 80% of the data set, and we compute decision trees for them and use the remaining 20% for validation. Ideally, for all these 5 different situations, slightly different situations, the decision trees are very, very similar. Yeah. So 5 is a number that's indeed used quite often, so that would be a 5-fold cross-validation. There could be also a 10-fold cross-validation. Larger values for k are quite untypical. Yeah. Yeah, so that is the standard method for validating such classifiers. So a decision tree may be assessed according to goodness criteria. Yeah, how good can the tree predict the target variable, e.g. the patient having cancer or a benign tumor? That is influenced, of course, by the sample size. Yeah, how many data sets do we have? It is influenced by the number of examples that are correctly classified. In medicine, it's typical to use the terms true positive, true negative, as well as false positive and false negative. True positive would mean, in our example, the patient has a cancer and the algorithm predicts that the patient has a cancer. And true negative would be the patient has no cancer, and that is also what the algorithm says based on the patient data that is available. Yeah, false positive would mean the patient actually has no cancer, but the system predicts a cancer. And false negative is the patient has no cancer, but the system No, that means the patient has cancer, but the system says it has no cancer. So that's accuracy, yeah, that is based on these four attributes. And complexity is, of course, a measure for the size of the tree. The smaller, the better. Let me briefly compare this to association rules that are also used for classification. Association rules have different parameters that characterize them. One of them is the confidence. Yeah? And the confidence means of an association rule, when I apply my association rules, because all assumptions are fulfilled, how reliably can I make the right conclusion? Yeah? How often does this happen? Customers that bought this book also were interested in this book. Yeah? So now we have a new customer that bought one book. Does he really later buy the second book? If not, we have a false positive, and that would reduce the confidence. And another important parameter of an association rule is the support. That means how often this rule actually applies. Customers that bought book A are very likely to buy book B. That would be an association rule that may have a large confidence, but if only three customers ever bought both books, then the support of this rule is very low. Yeah. So that is another aspect of association rules. A decision tree actually comprises classification rules at each level. Yeah, we always have splitting attributes and splitting values, and each of these situations can be directly written as an association rule. Yeah, so there is a quite tight connection between decision trees and association rules that may be derived from them. Yeah. Let me comment even a bit more on this trade-off, I would call it, between accuracy on the one hand and the size and comprehensibility of a decision tree on the other hand. Yeah? A highly accurate decision tree that is very large is strongly adapted to the training data, but maybe if in other data with some outliers or noise or missing values, it is not able to correctly predict results and classify the data. Yeah? If we have a large decision tree, then necessarily there must be many leaf nodes that comprise only a very few cases. And that tells you that this decision tree must be strongly sensitive to a few cases. Yeah? If I would remove these few cases that are here leading to certain nodes, then of course the tree must look differently. Yeah? And very likely, if a decision tree is quite complex, when it is transferred and applied to other data, probably the accuracy is lower, maybe even much lower, and that would indicate overfitting. Yeah? So overfitting occurs primarily if we have small data sets and large decision trees. Liu et al. Came up with a nice combined measure of effectiveness of decision trees, EDT, and that considered accuracy, yeah, namely the number of correct classifications. The more correct classifications we have, the higher is the effective decision tree, right? But it also considers the complexity of the node, of the tree, by subtracting, weighted with a certain factor, the number of leaf nodes as a measure for the complexity of the tree. Yeah? So every additional leaf node, because of this minus sign, reduces the effectiveness of the decision tree. And finally, as a further criterion, we have the number of data sets, yeah? The size of our database. That is a further criterion that is taken into account to compute the effectiveness of a decision tree. Yeah, strategies to reduce complexity. We may apply a feature selection step. That is something we discussed in the beginning of the dimension reduction lecture before starting the search, and we can thus reduce the number of dimensions. If we have fewer dimensions, then it's very likely that an automatically computed decision tree also is smaller. We may remove outliers that has different consequences that are positive for a decision tree. On the one hand, we have fewer data sets, and in particular, we have fewer data sets that are hard to classify. So probably outliers may lead to additional splitting nodes and splitting attributes in order to classify them. Yeah. So on the other hand, of course, we discussed this already. To remove outliers may make the further analysis easier, but the outliers may be real valid data sets. So yeah, we ignore part of the real complexity in order to solve our classification problem easier. Yeah, and that of course is a bit of an unfortunate situation. Yeah, so it's again important whether an outlier represents an unusual but realistic value, something that is valid, or whether it is indeed a wrong value, indicating a measurement error, a wrong sensor, for example, then of course it would lead to misleading classification results if we do not remove it. We could also apply clustering to partition the input data and then compute individual and separate decision trees for each cluster. Yeah, so that was also suggested and also makes sense, primarily if the number of clusters is not too small. Yeah, so in this paper it was suggested to use k-means clustering with a small number for k, and to apply decision trees for each of the resulting clusters. Yeah, we can prune decision tree computation. We can select splitting nodes where after we look at the precise data, it turns out they do not contribute so much to the accuracy, or we may replace one subtree by one node that is most important here for the classification. That would also reduce the complexity. Yeah. This pruning strategy is quite common. Different strategies, of course, may also be combined. Yeah, so that was basically everything I wanted to say with respect to the construction of a decision tree. Let's now describe how visualization can be used in this process, first to construct decision trees, to interactively refine decision trees, and finally to support an analytical reasoning process. So we want to visualize a decision tree, so that basically the tree structure with splitting nodes and splitting values and leaf nodes. But we also want to provide sufficient context. Yeah, and one essential aspect of this context is how many elements are in which class label corresponding to one leaf node. We want to visualize the training data, for example, the distributions of the variables and the relations of these variables to the target variables. Most tools focus only on the first task. It would be nice if an expert could be part of the model construction, the decision tree construction, but then it's really necessary to visualize the training data appropriately and effectively. Yeah, these were some very simple requirements, more specific requirements. A decision tree, or the decision trees, should be displayed as an overview. The overview should enable the selection of subtrees. So if we have more complex trees, we should not show the full and whole complexity at once, but enable the user to collapse or show certain subtrees. We should provide interaction in several views that are synchronized with each other. Zooming, of course, may be very important. Probing information, I'm interested in more details, for example, about the histogram of a certain dimension, and for customizing displays. It should be easy to recognize internal nodes and leaf nodes. They should be easy to discriminate. Yeah, and the class label of the leaf nodes should be displayed, how many are positive or negative in case that we have a binary target variable. Yeah, and the distribution of the splitting attribute would also be important in this example that I have showed on the title page. There we had, for example, the splitting attribute related to age, but we have not seen a histogram of the age of the patients. That would give us more context to understand, yeah, where in this overall distribution is the 61 year that the system computed. Yeah, so and the accuracy of the tree in total should always be updated. Yeah, that's what I want to see as an analyst. If I prune the tree, I remove some nodes and edges, I would like to see how this affects the accuracy. Hopefully, the error that I make is not so large, and if I can reduce the complexity considerably without introducing a large error, that would be a good thing. Yeah, there were several authors, Liu et al. And also Michael Ankers from Munich et al., who dealt with the potential of interaction with respect to decision trees. They both emphasized that with appropriate interaction, experts can integrate their domain knowledge, and that's often very useful for decision tree construction. In general, the decision trees constructed with sufficient user input are smaller compared to the automatically generated decision trees. Overfitting is smaller, and as a consequence of smaller trees, the interpretability is also better. Decision trees are constructed step by step. That's just the character of this really top-down algorithms, and intermediate results are displayed. Experts understand decision trees better if they can take part in their construction and interact actively influence it. And not only that they can understand the decision trees better, they develop more trust and satisfaction with respect to the resulting decision trees. One may also say the acceptance among analysts is better if there is a strong interactive component in decision tree construction. Yeah. So better trade-offs between accuracy and comprehensibility may be achieved. Yeah, algorithmic support, of course, is valuable. Yeah, I do not argue for fully interactive solutions. Algorithmic supports may show the consequence of the selection of a certain splitting attribute and splitting value. Yeah. So we mentioned already accuracy as a measure. Here I try to formalize how this is actually computed. We have basically four sets, four subsets of our data. We have two subsets that are correctly classified, correctly as positive or correctly as negative. So that increases our accuracy. And then we have two further sets, namely the data sets that are classified positively, but that was false, or those that are classified negatively, where this was false. Yeah? Ideally, both sets FP and FN have no elements. Then we divide the same number, a certain number by itself, so that would result in a 1, leading to a 100% accuracy. But as soon as either FP or FN is larger than 0, then this accuracy gets reduced and is no longer 100%. Yeah. I already made you aware of the fact that it could be useful to discriminate between false positives and false negatives. These are two different types of errors, and the consequences that they may have may be strongly different. And if this is the case, then it's not a good idea to optimize a decision tree only for accuracy, because optimizing only for accuracy basically treats false positive and false negatives in the same manner. Yeah, if one of them is more important, then you need a kind of weighted accuracy computation where the more important error has a higher weight and influences accuracy stronger. Yeah, let's look at basic techniques for individual trees. So we have computed one tree and we want to visualize it. Yeah, and we see here a very simple example where we have three split attributes. Here is one, the second one, and the third one, and we have four leaf nodes. Not a nicely balanced tree. Yeah, it would be nicer if we had two nodes on the left and two on the right, but yeah, that may happen quite typically. Yeah, so I think that is the most intuitive visualization, a node link diagram. Could be enhanced with arrows, which clearly show that this is a tree structure, that is the root, and the arrows show the direction from the root node to the leaf nodes. This is an indentation diagram, also called outline view. Yeah, so if we try to transform this representation to this one, well, you see that here we have L3 and L4. Yeah, they are here vertically aligned with each other. L2 and D3 are vertically aligned here. Yeah, D1 and L1, these two nodes, are also aligned here, and there is no corresponding node to D1 here. Yeah, so these are the different levels, D1, D2, D3, and then finally L3 as the leaf node level, where we don't have any splitting node anymore. And that these are the corresponding pair nodes to this. Yeah, so that's an indentation diagram. What you see here is a tree map. Yeah, a tree map, frequently used in information visualization, is also a kind of hierarchy visualization, but the hierarchy is shown very implicitly. Yeah, it's not so obvious. That's a technique that the user really must be familiar with. The nice property of a tree map is it is a space-filling approach, so it quite efficiently uses the available space. Yeah. What do we see here? We see that we have first L1, so we have split vertically, and that is L1. Then we split horizontally at the next level, where we have L2, and we have to split once more horizontally in L3 and L4, representing these two nodes. Yeah. So basically, in a tree map, you do not see the intermediate nodes, the decision nodes. You only see the five leaf nodes. Here is a tree ring. Yeah, same structure and hierarchy is shown. L4, which no further could be refined. Here we have the different decision trees leading to concentric rings. So that indicates the hierarchy a bit better compared to a tree map where it is fully implicit. And this technique that's visible here is called an icicle plot. Yeah, we will see and discuss this later. The example is indeed very small, so the question is not which of these variants you prefer for this simple example. You would need to explore these techniques with larger data sets. Yeah, here are examples of indentation diagrams from papers that I have partially already cited. That must be a medical example. So here we have a bypass. Here we have further attributes that go more and more in detail. Another variant where you clearly see this indentation. Then we have the leaf nodes, and we go back in the hierarchy to higher levels. And yeah, then we here have again folders, representing to the splitting nodes. Yeah, node link diagrams are frequently used, often the default techniques to convey a decision tree. The example here is from SAS. Yeah, there are also SPSS examples. So that is available in many data mining tools. Yeah. We see here a number of values that are important to characterize splitting nodes and also leaf nodes. Related to accuracy, we also see the sample size, so how many elements fall in this part of the graph and how many fall in this part. Actually, this number is not too expressive, it could be 1 and 2, or 1 and 2 again, or here it is 3 samples that we have. Yeah, let's come back to the example that we have briefly discussed at the beginning, where we have a decision tree with the specific decisions, and for each decision we see whether the tumor is malignant or benign. Yeah, so here we have 47 persons that fall in this category, 38 have a malignant tumor and only 9 have no malignant tumor. Yeah, so these numbers here are quite important. So this layout was computed with graph drawing algorithms, and such graph drawing algorithms probably you would not program yourself, but use it from information visualization toolkits like GraphViz. That's just an example for this. Yeah, let's look again in tree maps and tree rings and comment a bit on this. Yeah, tree maps, as you see here, are efficient space-filling approaches. That is their clear advantage. But the topology of the tree is hard to understand. Basically, an analyst must really understand the process of creating a tree map, of constructing these vertical and horizontal splits to understand this. Yeah. Here is an example enhanced with decision nodes, so that it is clear the decision node D1 refers to these two leaf nodes. This decision node refers to the splitting between these three leaf nodes, and finally D3 is related to splitting between L3 and L4. That can be shown in such an enhanced view. However, you can easily imagine that only works if the tree is not too complex. Yeah, we have a bit space available to comment here on one further decision node, and maybe also here, but with more than 5 decision nodes, this would not work well. Yeah. Yeah, the tree rings are not so efficient in the sense that they are not completely space-filling, but on the other hand, the topology of the tree is harder to understand. I mentioned already the icicle plots and showed already an example for this. This is this example again. Yeah, the whole data set, the first attribute that can be used here for splitting D1, and then we have L1 corresponding, and for those values that do not fall in this L1 category, they are used here for splitting between D3 and L2, and then we have the final split in L4 and L3. Yeah, so these indentations here are important to convey the hierarchy. Yeah, the space is used here better than with node link diagrams. Node link diagrams really require a considerable amount of space. I would say that the hierarchy is better perceived here with icicle plots compared to tree maps and also tree rings, but of course not as clear as with node link diagrams. Yeah? The topology is less obvious. That is the disadvantage that we really have here. Yeah, when we have hundreds of variables, decision trees may be large. Here's an example with a decision tree that has 179 nodes. I could not even show all of them. And 93 of the nodes are leaf nodes. Yeah. So an overview detail combination would be quite helpful. Here we see this large decision tree, and here we see in this overview visualization that the user specified a rectangular subset, and that is what we see here in detail. Yeah, nodes and subtrees may be selected in an overview and may be shown in an additional view with additional information, yeah, like you see it here, where, for example, the distribution of the green values and the blue values is actually shown in a similar way here in distribution of the data is shown. Yeah, let me make finally a few remarks on evaluation of these basic decision tree visualization techniques. Essential criteria are should be easy to identify the tree topology. So you may ask your users how they assess the topology. You know how the topology really is. You can compare this and with this try to understand how well this visualization supports an understanding of the tree topology. You may also analyze how easy it is to identify relations between nodes, and you can try to understand the ease of identification of certain leaf sizes. Yeah? The users may also have some preferences. You may ask for them. That could be also an important part of the evaluation. Yeah, so that was what I wanted to say in this first video lecture, where we looked at the algorithms to compute decision trees, the kind of problems that can be solved with decision trees, and finally, we looked at some criteria for visualization techniques for interactive exploration, and we've got to see some simple basic visualization techniques like node link diagrams, icicle plots, indentation views, tree maps, and tree rings. We will go on in the next video lecture with discussing advanced visualizations. You see already an example here. Yeah, with this, I want to thank you again.